You can do.
Is that Wi-Fi?
Yeah, it's turned off, so. Sorry about that, just realized we had some technical difficulties. We'll be starting from here, I guess. Just go on from here. I hope you guys enjoy those first two songs that we did. I enjoyed singing them with you. So from here, we're going to do, we're going to play a video for you called I Will Rise, and then we'll do the announcement. So go ahead and hit that video when you got it, and I hope you guys enjoy it.
There's a peace I've come to know, though my heart and flesh may fail. There's an anchor for my soul. I can say it is well. Jesus has overcome, and the grave. There's a day that's drawing near, when this darkness breaks to light, and the shadows disappear, and my faith shall be my eyes. Jesus has overcome, and the grave. Is one. He is risen.
announcements for the week. Of course, we are still doing everything contactless as far as our visiting goes. We did figure out the tape recorder situation, so we appreciate those who reached out about that. We are still putting together packets for our bus kids and their families as far as reading materials, tracks, coloring pages, and things like that. Having a lot of people already reach out. Appreciate that. We continue to get that support together and figure out how to do that. If you have any ideas, let us know. If you'd like to help, let us know. And again, even though we are closed to the public and only streaming services online, we are here every day, myself and Pastor, and we want to help out in any way we can. If you know anybody who's in need, please reach out to us. We'd be glad to do anything we can for them. Of course, we'll still be gathering together. Excuse me, not gathering together. We'll still be getting together a little bit to record Wednesday. So be looking out for that, our Wednesday night service at 7. We hope you guys can make it. Please don't forget to like, share, and subscribe to our YouTube page. Make sure you hit the bell and the icon so you can get all the notifications on our upcoming videos. Make sure you follow us on Facebook. And you can, that way you can see all our videos as well. We've heard about more people viewing and seeing a lot of those numbers increase. We're glad to see that. We are glad to provide this opportunity for you guys who are unable to make it to go ahead and stream on our services online. So a camp is still coming up. That's the 1st or the 6th of June. Be looking forward to that. That has not changed. Nothing's going to change on that as far as I know. As long as this quarantine is lifted before then, plan on going. So at this time, that's all I have. Oh, I'm sorry. One more thing I forgot. We did make the our website. You can now give your tithes and offerings through our website. If you'll click on go to our website, WascoFWBC.com. That's WascoFWBC.com. Scroll down to the giving section. Click the yellow button that says donate. You'll be taken to a PayPal page, and there you can type in your information, the amount you would like to give, and set that all up. It's secure, and we've already seen people give that way. We appreciate it. I want to say a big thank you to that for your continued support of our church. We look forward to the day when we can all get back together once this whole thing is passed. So be in prayer for that. At this time, we're going to go ahead and have Pastor come and lead one song. So give him a hand as he comes.
All right. When Brother Paul made the statement, I'm going to lead the song. Actually, in other words, it's a special. It's a the song called He's Alive. And so if you would appreciate you praying for me. I just usually do this song once a year. And so if you would appreciate you praying for me as I bring this song up, if you would please, okay? So I need to get a little bit more time as far as that goes. Okay, this song right here called He's Alive is something that spoke to my heart when I first got saved. In other words, when I heard it, and it's been a favorite, in other words, for mine, for me, as far as that goes. So if you would appreciate you praying for me, if you would please. Thank you. by him, and then I saw him die. Switch this over to Brother Paul, if you would. We'd appreciate that.
Amen. I look forward to that every year, don't you?
Amen. Amen.
Let me switch this over here. We've got one more video we'd like to show you. We're going to go ahead and play this video. This song is called My Living Savior, My Living Hope, excuse me. So we're going to go ahead and play this video now. Hope you enjoy it. After that, Pastor will take the stage.
Jesus Christ, my living.
Grab your Bibles if you would, and turn to the book of Luke, chapter number 24, if you would please. The book of Luke in chapter number 24, if you would. We're going to go ahead and go a little bit further, if you would, numbers in the passage of Scripture as we dealt with numbers this morning. So if you would, the book of Luke, if you will, chapter number 24, if you would, would appreciate you turning there. I'm just going to read a few verses, if you will. I'm going to set ourselves inside part two, if you will, the resurrection walk, words, wonder, and witness. And every one of these parts, if you will, these four different parts, can find, if you will, a Christian, in other words, in some part, in other words, of their Christian life. And I believe seriously, in other words, I think it's important for us to take a look at where do we find ourselves at.
Right.
We've already dealt in verse with a couple of points, if you will. Didn't get through the second point, but if you would, take a look at your bill. Luke chapter 24, verse 13 through 15, it says, and behold, two of them went that same day to a village called Emmaus, which was from Jerusalem about 84 furlongs. And they talked together of all these things which had happened. And it came to pass that while they communed together and reasoned, Jesus himself drew near and went with them. Let's go to the Lord in prayer once again, ask God to bless. Father, we come to you now, Lord, in the precious name of Jesus once again, asking you, Father, right now, Lord, just to speak to hearts. We pray that you would. Pray, Father, right now that, Lord, you would help us to show us where we find ourselves as Christians today. Since the context is two disciples, if you will, a husband and wife walking, if you will, from Jerusalem, in other words, to a place called Emmaus, about 6.5, maybe 7 miles away. And there's where it is. There's a revelation, if you will, of how believers, if you will, find themselves where they're at from, and where it is, in other words, they need to go to. And I pray, Father, right now that you would help me, Lord, to be able to preach in a way tonight, Lord, to be pleasing to you, to be able to apply to our lives here on this Resurrection Sunday. Lord, love you today. Thank you, praise you, ask all in the precious name of Jesus, and for a sacred prayer. And all of God's people said, amen.
Amen.
Amen. I want you to take a look, and I'm going to pretty well kind of run through this thing because I've still got a whole bunch of other words to preach. So I may just kind of just preach this thing. The walking and the resurrection, and simply numbers the idea that two, they're disciples, both of them, if you will. They're walking, in other words, heading towards, apparently, in other words, their home there in Emmaus, about 6.5 to 7 miles away. The distance from almost a little bit, in other words, more between Moscow and Shafter there. Takes about 2 hours, 15 minutes, 2.5 hours, something along that line. Just checking with Google, if you will, finding out, in other words, how long it might be. We've actually had some people make the statement that's about how long it takes. And one of them's name is Cleopas, if you will. We find out the idea that Cleopas is with, if you will, his wife was actually at the cross. So we're just going to hit this and kind of run through this whole thing. The town, and I'm not going to go back through and talk about this little podunk town, but it's just the idea that, in other words, you realize and understand some of the little podunk town can be used, in other words, of the Lord, no getting around that. If you'll just simply just allow him, his presence and his power into your life and into your family's life, if you will, there's where it is. He can do some great, in other words, wonder-filled things, if you will. So,
right.
And I just want to kind of just run through this right quick. And so all of a sudden, we get to the idea of the talk it is. We find out, in other words, that this couple, if you will, are talking about what it is that have gone on for the last 3 days there in Jerusalem. They found themselves during the Passover and that the Passion and that the Passover week, and that they found themselves, in other words, there inside Jerusalem. And as it is, in other words, they do this. Here's where the crucifixion happened. Here's where it is. All of a sudden, in other words, you realize their world is turned, if you will, upside down. They're talking about all these things that happened. The spirit of their talk is the idea that, in other words, they talked together, they communed, if you will, together, and reasoned. And if you take all them Greek words and put it together there, from what I understand, means the other night, they were having themselves some an intense moments of fellowship, if you will. In other words, as they're walking along there, and that's what, in other words, got the Lord's attention. The traveler, of course, in other words, is the Lord Jesus Christ. The involvement in him, that he sits there and he draws himself near to them. And by the way, and I made the statement this morning, made again the idea, if you want the presence of the Lord to get close to you, talk about spiritual things.
That's right.
Talk about the things of God. Talk about the Word of God. Talk about the work of God. And doing, my friend, that, there's where it is. You can almost guarantee the idea that he's going to show up, because the Bible says wherever two or three are gathered together in my name, there I am, says, in the midst. And that's a promise, if you will, before, if you will, the resurrection. But he knew the Lord Jesus Christ did. He knew that there was after his resurrection, there's where it is, or whatever, two or three are gathered together in his name and by his authority, talking about the things of God, the word of God, the work of God. I guarantee you, he's going to draw close to you. If you like that, say amen.
Amen.
I need to hurry. The ignorance about this traveler, the Bible says that somewhere along the line, the Bible says that there was the Lord held their eyes. Their eyes were holden that they might not know him. And the reason is because apparently, him preaching to them for the idea of possibly almost 3 years, not sure exactly how, but they've been disciples for a while. They were certainly dedicated. There was no doubts about this, especially the wife, her being at the cross when essentially and basically there wasn't much people else along that line. But nonetheless, the idea, they had heard the Lord Jesus Christ preach. We're going to find that out. And there's where it is that somewhere along the line, him preaching, in other words, in the flesh, him preaching live, if you will, apparently the verse didn't do exactly what it is that it should have done.
Right.
So what the Lord has decided to do, he's not going to reveal himself, and he's just simply going to hide himself, if you will, and he's going to work, and he's going to do, and he's going to deal with them, if you will, under the guise, if you will, of just simply a traveler going right along with them. Let me go a little bit further if I could. The words about this resurrection, first there's an inquiry. The idea of the Lord, in other words, making the statement, what manner of communication are these, he said, in other words, that you have, and as you walk together, and you're sad.
Yeah.
Why in the world, in other words, should a Christian be sad? One of the reasons is because somewhere along the line, there's where it is, they've lost the Savior.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
They've lost, if you will, the Lord Jesus Christ. He was someplace in a grave, someplace completely away from them. He was crucified, if you will, right before her eyes, for a matter of fact. Their eyes, if you will, some that isn't, that sit there and watch this situation. And all of a sudden, there's where it is, they buried him, and all of a sudden, it's done. It's over with. It's finished. And there's where it is immediately. They're sad.
Right.
Why? Because they don't know what to do now. They don't have a clue. In other words, what to do. Could this be where a lot of Christians are at right now?
Yeah.
That their Savior's gone out of their life. Their Savior is dead, if you will. Their Savior, if you will, is hidden someplace. And there's where it is. In other words, they find themselves sad. And I made a statement this morning about the thought and the idea that, in other words, a lot of those disciples, in other words, were mourning and weeping, if you will, in Mark chapter 10. John chapter says, Mary stood without, in other words, the sepulcher, weeping, if you will. She didn't like, in other words, how this situation was. And she didn't like it. She's going to do something about that. She's going to constantly, I appreciate the thought about staying as close as she could, even if you will, to a dead Savior. You say, what is your point about the whole thing? How about the idea, if you seemingly have lost the Lord, or you can't find him, or he's, in other words, absent from your life, how about going back to the last place where it is that you saw him?
That's good.
Yeah.
Last place that you know, in other words, he was alive. The last place, in other words, come on, somebody ought to say, he said, well, but the idea about them going, in other words, where it is that he's dead, yeah, she's just trying to do right, bringing those spices, if you will. Need to get bogged down. I need to hurry. The subject of their conversation, he said what things, and then all of a sudden the investigation, there's where it is. In other words, Cleopas sits there and kind of goes off, if you will, on the Lord. He makes the statement, the idea, are you just a stranger? I mean, do you have a clue what it is that's been going on? This wasn't done in a corner. Everybody knows about the Lord's what it is that has happened there as far as that goes. And he starts informing about the place of Jesus.
Yeah.
Jesus of Nazareth. And I'm not going to go back through this thing like I did earlier. He's Jesus of Nazareth. But you know what? That's not the only place he's from.
That's right.
He said, well, where's he from? Not Bethlehem. He's also, my friend, from the glories of heaven.
Amen.
The position of Jesus, he was a prophet, but that wasn't all he was. He's still a priest, if you will. He's still a potentate, still a king, if you will. The power of the Lord Jesus Christ. Oh, they saw it. They saw a lot of miracles. There's no getting around that. And there's where it is that you realize he's all powerful.
Amen.
As far as that goes. And that's what they didn't realize as far as that goes. The idea that there was all the miracles that he did, they act like somewhere along the line, there's some kind of a limitation. There's no limitation to the Lord Jesus Christ. He said, all power is given unto me. That's the resurrected Christ, if you will. That's the resurrected Lord Jesus Christ. He said, all power is given unto me in heaven and in earth.
Mm-hmm.
Come on.
All right.
Now let me go on. How about the preaching of Jesus? Now this is where this thing kind of falls a little bit short. I believe the verse, they heard a lot of preaching. They didn't hear all they should. We're going to find that out in a little bit. How about the verse, he was mighty in word, praise of Jesus. Everybody knew the numbers that he was something special. No getting around that before God and all the people. He's persecuted by the chief priests and the rulers. And they condemned him to be crucified. The perception about Jesus, we trusted that he should redeem, if you will, Israel. And I'm trying to hurry through this thing, but you know what? Their redemption, they thought the verse, there's where it is. They're going to bring about, if you will, some kind of golden kingdom, some kind of a millennium, or where it is. In other words, there's where it is, the Jewish nation, or the Israel, if you will. In other words, it's supposed to set up a kingdom, if you will, and rule and reign over everybody. Say, well, where'd they get that at? I don't know. I don't know where they got that out of the Old Testament. They sure didn't. I can't find it. And I can't find it in the New Testament either, as far as that goes. Matter of fact, my Bible tells me that the Lord Jesus Christ told, if you will, the chief rulers of the Isaiah, he said, in other words, he said, I'm going to take the kingdom of God from you and give it to a nation that's going to bring forth some fruit like it's supposed to.
That's right.
Yeah.
See, I don't know why, in other words, somebody doesn't see that in the Bible, that he took that kingdom away from the Jewish nation.
Right.
Now, let me go on. They talk about the idea about being redeemed, in other words, not with corruptible things as silver and gold, like the golden age, if you will, of Solomon, and how it is that he ruled and reigned, in other words, at one time, but it was with the precious blood of the Lord Jesus Christ. Right. They didn't like that.
Right.
They didn't like this idea about suffering.
No.
Didn't like this idea about self-denial.
Yeah.
Didn't like this idea about sacrifice.
Right.
Matter of fact, I'll be honest with you, I don't know a whole lot of Christians that actually do as far as that goes. And actually, what they'd like to do is just kind of stay away from that. But I need to hurry a little bit further with this whole thing. I want you to see the eighth thing about the prediction. It said, besides all this, this is the third thing. This is where it is we left off at, in other words, this morning. The third thing, if you will. This is the third day these things were done. You know what? Lord's not through. And I guarantee you, he can be 4 days late and still be on time. That's the kind of Savior it is that I serve. Come on, somebody ought to say amen. Now let me go a little bit further with the whole thing. And then all of a sudden, he talks about the proclamation about Jesus. And all of a sudden, here's where it is, Cleopas, he tells the Lord, he says, yea, and certain of our women also of our company made, in other words, us astonished, which were early at the sepulcher. And when they found, in other words, not his body, they came, saying that they had also seen a vision of angels which said that he was, he's alive. All of a sudden, this thing changes.
Right.
The attitude of the Lord all of a sudden, when he confesses the idea that, in other words, not only do I know all about the Lord Jesus Christ, like I've just got to explain, we've got the testimony of some of the women that have told us the idea. They went there and that tomb is empty.
Amen.
Why in the world didn't that spark, if you will, in other words, some
joy,
some faith, if you will, the idea about in other words, maybe there's something fixing to happen here.
Yeah.
Why in other words, all of a sudden, did they just kind of blow that off? I don't know about you, but when somebody testifies to you about a living Savior, about the idea that, in other words, that they all of a sudden realize, in other words, the Lord is not where it is he was at, in a dead situation, but in other words, now it is, that place is empty. Why in the world would that not pique your interest? Why in the world would that, in other words, not immediately cause you to maybe just wait and find out, in other words, what in the world is going on? But then it gets worse. Then all of a sudden he says, the probing about Christ, it says, and certain of them which were with us, that'd be John and Peter, went to the sepulcher, found it even so as the women had said, but they saw him, they saw not.
Right.
But it's still, in other words, more, if you will, witnesses to the idea that he's not dead.
Right.
He's not where it is that he was at. Why in the world did they, in other words, probe a little bit farther their own selves to find out what in the world? No, sometimes I'll be honest with you, I think Christians would just as soon instead of probe into this thing a little bit further, find out where the Lord's at. Come on.
Amen.
Find out where the Lord's at. They'd just soon go home. They'd just soon think the idea, it's too late.
Right.
It's been 3 days. It's just too late. They ain't no use in going any further to find out. Well, I don't know about you folks, the smartest thing it is we can do is, we need to find out where the Lord's at. And there's where it is we need to go.
Mm-hmm.
There's where it is, my friend, we need to stay.
Yeah.
There's where it is, my friend, that we need to find ourselves, in other words, in his presence. Let me go on. The indicting words, all of a sudden the Lord brings an indictment to these individuals. He can't stand it no longer. He sat there, in other words, and he's unfolded, if you will, what was it? 10 different things. 10 different things, in other words. And about that time, when he sits there and finds out the idea that they had a less of a view about him, that wasn't right completely, and all of a sudden the testimony of the women and the testimony, if you will, of some of the disciples, that in other words caused them to sit there and go home,
right?
All of a sudden there's an indictment, if you will, found in these words. This indictment kind of goes like this, if you will. First of all, he sits there and he opens his mouth, and he does is he talks about, you know what, you've got nothing but a senseless faith. All of a sudden, the Lord makes a statement in verse 25. Then he said unto them, O fools. Ooh.
Rough.
I mean, you know, that's a little bit on the rough side.
Yeah. Right.
That means the idea that your actions and what you're doing right now and what you have done, what you're thinking, what you've said, what have you, is nothing but foolishness.
Right.
Now, I don't know about you, but you realize that ought to stop these people dead in their tracks. They ought to quit walking, stop right there, and find out why it is this individual believes it is, in other words, that what they're doing is foolishness.
Right.
Find out, in other words, what in the world it is, if you will, it's going on.
Yeah.
All of a sudden, and you say, well, they don't know he's the Lord. Yeah, I know that. But why in the world is this individual that they're talking to all of a sudden stopping after they're given a testimony of 10 different points about the Lord Jesus Christ? Why in the world is this man stopping and say, oh, fools, you're being foolish about what it is that you're doing. You're being foolish about what it is that you're saying.
Yeah.
You're being foolish about your actions. You're being foolish, if you will. I don't know about you, but that ought to stop somebody dead off their tracks and find out, in other words, what in the world is going on.
Right.
That's why they're sad.
Right.
That's why they're maybe mad. That's why maybe the idea that they're bad. But I know one thing, they're not glad.
Right.
And then the next thing, if you will, numbers in this indictment that the Lord brings about, he said, numbers, not only do you have a senseless faith, you've also got a slow faith. He makes the statement to them, he said, oh, fools and slow of heart to believe.
Right.
You know what the problem was? The problem wasn't the head. It wasn't the head. You say, well, what do you mean it wasn't the head? Well, they had quite a bit of evidence about the Lord Jesus Christ, didn't they?
Yes.
As a matter of fact, members, the idea they had, you know what the problem was? They had all the pieces of the puzzle. They just couldn't put it together like it's supposed to be. Mm-hmm. See, there's a lot of folks, I'll be honest with you, that have got a lot of information about the Lord.
Yeah.
A whole lot of information about the Lord in their head. The problem is, my friend, these individuals, it wasn't a head problem.
The heart problem.
It was a heart problem.
Yeah, that's right.
Somewhere along the line, all that head knowledge that they had, the words they just unfolded about 10 different things as far as that goes, they couldn't put it together here.
Right.
It was a heart problem. He said, in other words, you're slow of heart. Oh, it's not slow of mind. Oh, you spit those 10 things out, in other words, in a heartbeat. Almost like a machine, if you will. But the problem is, in other words, about 18 inches away, if you will, in other words, what it is that's needed, the idea is, in other words, the heart being like where it is and it's supposed to be.
Right.
Then all of a sudden, in other words, in this indictment, in other words, not only a senseless faith and a slow faith, all of a sudden it's a selective faith. Here's where I'm going to stay a little while.
Come on.
The reason is because this selective faith, he said, oh, fools and slow of heart to believe all that the prophets have spoken.
Yeah.
Can I talk to y'all? You know what the biggest problem with most Christians today? They don't believe the whole thing.
Yeah.
They don't believe all that it is the prophets have spoken. They don't believe all the word of God.
Yeah.
They don't believe the whole counsel of God.
Yeah,
come
right.
on. Oh, they got bits and pieces. They love the idea about prosperity. Mm. They love the idea about the words love. They love the idea about them. There's a whole lot of things it is that they think they've got. But all of a sudden, there's where it is when it talks about surrender. It talks about sacrifice. Mm-hmm. It talks, if you will, about self-denial. Come on. Yeah. It talks about suffering. Yeah. Oh, Christians don't want to hear that.
Yeah.
Right.
Oh, my God. They don't want to hear about convictions. They don't want to hear about standards. They don't want to hear about practices. They don't want to hear, if you will, about the idea about the words living right, living godly. They don't want to hear about holiness.
Yeah.
They don't want to hear about godliness, about separation. They don't want to hear about separation.
Right. Right.
Oh, my goodness gracious alive. Oh, matter of fact, Brother Danny, stuff like that, that's part of the problem. No, 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 that's not part of the problem. That's a part of the solution.
Yeah, that's right.
Good.
Yeah, that's right.
They're selective, if you will, in their faith. They're not believing, if you will, my friend, all it is that the prophets have spoken. You go back in the Old Testament, and you sit there, my friend, and I can ask any Jewish individual you want to, my friend, a simple question like that. Why is it saying that in the book of Daniel that Messiah shall be cut off?
Right.
That Messiah shall be cut off and not for himself.
Right.
Why does it make the statement that the sacrifice, the offering, what have you, shall cease? Why can't they explain Isaiah chapter 53 talking about the suffering servant, if you will, the suffering Savior? And none of those Jewish people, my friend, want to talk about that.
Right.
All they want to talk about is the idea about the verse, this rock coming out of the sky, blasting, if you will, at the feet of that image, if you will, of Nebuchadnezzar. And there's where it is that that kingdom shall be an everlasting kingdom, shall end up taking over the whole world. That's all they want to focus on.
Right.
That's all they want to focus on. They want to talk about a crown. They don't ever want to talk about a cross.
Amen.
And must Jesus bear the cross alone and all the world go free? No! There's a cross for everyone. There's a cross for me.
Amen.
You know, we don't want to talk about no cross.
Right.
We want to hear about self-denial, sacrifice, suffering. Don't want to hear about that. Oh, goodness gracious, are you kidding me? Don't you realize we're in America? Yeah, that's the problem.
Right.
And I guarantee you, my friend, that the Lord Jesus Christ can bring, in other words, even fat cat America to its knees.
Right.
As a matter of fact, it's bending pretty good, in other words, right now.
Right.
Yeah. And all it's taking is, if you will, a little strain of the flu. That's all it takes. Come on.
That's
all it takes. And can actually stop, if you will, this nation. Put it to a screeching, stinking halt, if you will.
Right.
Come on. Almost burn Australia up. Mm-hmm. In Africa right now, the locusts and what have you are eating everything that there is alive.
Right.
You say, what do you think God's trying to do? I don't know. Maybe Isaiah, 2 Chronicles chapter 7, verse 14.
Right.
That in other words, if I bring a pestilence and I bring some disease
right. And
I bring, in other words, some hardships and what have you, my people which are called by my name will humble themselves and pray, seek my face. Come on.
Yeah.
He said, in other words, you can hear from heaven.
Nice.
I'll be glad to heal your land, but not living like you do.
Amen.
Not living like you do. Yeah. See, somebody, my friend, apparently ain't listening to the whole word of God. You do realize, you say, why is these diseases coming? Well, it's because we're just like the heathen. You realize the Lord promised, if you will, this is going to be worth it. The Lord promised, if you will, in other words, if you live the verse like it is, I want you to live by my laws in the Old Testament. He said, I'll put none of these diseases on you.
Yeah.
Come on. That's right. Found in heathen nations.
That's right.
I'll put none of those diseases on you. Well, let me go on here. This is Resurrection Sunday. Ho, ho, ho. Happy Resurrection Sunday. How about the instructing of these words? First of all, the suffering of the Savior. I got ahead of myself. I'm sorry. Ought not Christ to have suffered these things?
Right.
Huh?
That's right.
See, you never thought about the idea that, in other words, this is the way this thing's supposed to go.
Right.
Come on. How about the idea of the splendor, he says, and then he's going to enter into his glory.
Yeah.
It's not right. That he's through.
Right.
Suffering, my friend, is just a part of this situation. That's not where we're going to stay at.
Right.
Come on. He said, in other words, then he says, the scripture is instructing, and beginning at Moses, that'd be the first five books of the Bible.
Right.
He said, in other words, in all the prophets, that'd be the rest of the Bible, rest of the Old Testament, he expounded unto them all the scriptures, the things concerning who?
Himself.
Himself. Oh, is anybody getting this thing?
It's good.
You say, well, what is your point about that? I'm glad you asked. You realize the Lord Jesus Christ just is fixing to preach, if you will, a 2.5-hour sermon.
Yeah.
A 2.5-hour sermon, yeah. That's essentially what it is that I'm doing today. An hour this morning and an hour and a half tonight.
Right.
Say, why in the world do you want to do that? Well, because I just don't want you to be sad.
Right.
And the only way I can get you from being sad or mad or bad is just preach. Preach everything out of the Bible, start to finish. Somebody ought to say amen. Every bit of it. And you need to start believing all of it.
Amen.
Not this selective faith that we just got through talking about. Oh my goodness, can you imagine the idea, a 2.5 hour sermon by the Lord Jesus Christ as you're walking along and you're thinking to yourself, oh my goodness, what in the world? Then all of a sudden the wonder of the resurrection is beginning to start to happen. Are y'all ready for this? If you are, say amen.
Amen.
Oh, now the wonder comes. We've already heard about the walk. And you've been walking with the Lord for quite a while, but you're still sad. Isn't that interesting? How in the world can you be sad walking with the Lord? Well, when you don't know that He's the Lord, and you don't know that you're walking with Him,
right.
And you don't have a clue, in other words, who it is that He is, how it is it is, what He is, and how He is, and everything else,
where
he's from, as far as that goes, you do realize immediately there's where it is by right. You're going to end up being sad,
right?
Half the time, most of the time, you're going to be mad,
right?
And figure out what in the world's going on here. Why ain't this thing working for me like it is out here? All some of them preachers talk about as far. Why ain't this thing working like it is that I think it ought to work? And then you get bad. See, you know, you're used to living right. Might as well start living like everybody else. Why? Because I'm sad. And I'm mad. So you might as well go ahead and be
bad.
Might as well go ahead and be bad. No, I think you ought to stay with this situation. See what the Lord's got for you so you can be glad.
Amen.
And here's where the wonder of this resurrection. I love this part right here. The proving, if you will, for the wonder. The proving is a test that the Lord, in other words, had for these individuals. And by the way, He's got for everybody else also,
amen,
not just these folks. First of all, the posturing, if you will, of the proving. Verse 28 says, in other words, that He drew nigh to the village where they were going, and whither they went. He says, and He made though He would have gone
further.
So what does that mean? It means the idea that as He walks, in other words, along this way, they're fixing to turn this direction to head, in other words, where it is they live at, and the Lord just kind of keeps, in other words, just going straight.
Right.
Because He
right.
believes in a straight gate in a
narrow way.
In a narrow way. And about that time, they all of a sudden realize, in other words, the Lord is fixing to head on out of here, away from them. And all of a sudden, he said, why in the world would the Lord do something like that? He's just wanting to know if you want Him around all the time.
Yeah, that's right.
You know, it's amazing to me. And by the way, we're going to find out the idea. You know, you realize, in other words, y'all can't come to church. Mm-hmm. You're going to need to ask yourself a question. Are you glad that you can't come to church?
Right.
Would you just as soon have it this way?
Come on.
Well, you say, well, brother, you act like, in other words, I can't have the presence of the Lord right where it is yet. Well, go ahead. But I don't know about you, but you realize He's ordained, in other words, the church.
Amen.
I got a question to ask you. Are you to the point where it is like you just can't wait to get back, in other words, here? In the fellowship, if you will, the words with His church, that where two or three are gathered together in His name, that there you are in the midst of. Come on.
Right.
Or are you one of those that is that say, you know what? I kind of like this. Yeah.
That's right.
Kind of like this. I don't know about you, but I like the people, my friend, that are mad because they can't be here.
Yeah, that's right.
Amen.
In other words, they'd be too soon. In other words, let me just go on here. He acts like he's going to go further.
Right.
Acts like he's going to end up going further. You say, well, Brother Eddie, are you sure that's what that means? Sure, he does that all the time. He's done it before.
Right.
Remember when, in other words, he told the disciples, get in that boat and head over to the other side.
Yeah.
And whenever they got out there, a big old storm came up.
Yeah.
And you remember there's where it is the Lord Jesus Christ come walking on the water. Well, let's read it right quick. It says, and when He saw them toiling and rowing, for the wind was contrary. See, I don't know about you. You realize, now let me go on. Let me work on it right now. He says, about the fourth watch of the night, that's right in the middle of the night, He cometh unto them walking upon the sea and would have passed them by.
That's right.
See, you think that the Lord never just going to jump in the middle of your storm and stop it? No. When you're stressed, just like those two on the way to Emmaus, see, he'd be glad, in other words, to stop your stress, and he'd be glad to stop your storms. Right. But you know what it is he's wanting? He's wanting an invite.
That's good.
He's wanting you to invite him into your situation. You realize you can sit there, in other words, and you can row contrary to the wind, my friend, on a regular basis, and the storms that comes up in your life, and he'll let you go ahead and do it. But I don't know about you, but Peter's smart enough to sit there and say, Lord, hold it. If that's you,
bid me
to come on out there.
Yeah. That's right.
Amen.
Come on. Yeah. You say, well, why in the world would Peter want to do that? Because he's seen that, in other words, the storm and the trouble and the trials and the tribulation was under the feet of the Lord Jesus Christ. And he wanted to be out there where the storm, my friend, wasn't bothering him.
Right.
So he goes out there where he's at. He would no longer be bothering him. They wouldn't be bothering them.
Right.
If I can just get out there where the Lord's at.
That's good. Preacher, brother.
Oh, my goodness. This is Resurrection Sunday.
Amen.
You say, well, what is your point? Well, how many knows, in other words, that Cleopas and his wife, they're stressed out.
Right.
They're sad. They don't stay that way. They realize they got themselves a little bit of rest while the Lord Jesus Christ is preaching a 2-hour message to them.
Right.
Mm-hmm. They realize all of a sudden that stress is gone. Their heart, in other words, no longer is slow. Their heart now is searing. Come on.
That's good.
Now, I'm getting ahead of myself. I'm sorry. It says in the plea for the proving, it says, and but they constrained him, saying, stay with us.
Right.
Lord, don't leave us. Stay with us. The reason is because, in other words, we're not sad anymore.
Right.
So why is that? Well, because faith, my friend, when it's senseless and it's slow and it's selective, then all of a sudden when you get enough word down inside of you, my friend, next thing you know, that faith, see, faith comes by hearing the right kind and hearing by the word of God. And when you get 2.5 hours of word, I mean, who knows, you ought to be able to do quite a few things.
Yeah, that's right.
And they realize that. I need to hurry. The persuasion in this proving, I got a question. See, some of you, I'm afraid, you'd sit there and say, yeah, well, I'd like to have the Lord around here. Oh, wouldn't you? Now, you really think the Lord's going to stick around when you're sitting there acting like that? Well, yeah, I guess so.
Right.
Now, how about the idea about persuading the Lord to stick around?
Right.
Are you willing to stick? Are you willing to persuade the Lord to stick? Why don't you give him a reason for sticking around?
That's good.
Yeah, that's good.
And there's where the idea they made this: abide with us. Why? For it's towards evening. It's getting late. It's the idea that there is the day is far spent. Come on, stick with us. Stay with us. What reason do you want to stick and to stay?
Right.
We want you here. We want you because what it is you've got is exactly what we need.
Amen.
That's good.
If you got people sit there and say, well, I just feel like, in other words, it is, I'm no use to the Lord. Well, become useful then. Yeah. Give the Lord a reason, if you will, my friend. Give the Lord a reason to keep you around.
Yeah.
Health hits you as far from that bad, as far as that goes. Say, Lord, I don't know about you, but I want to stick around. I want to live for you. I want to love you. I want to live for you. I want to train my family right. Give him a reason to keep you around.
It's good.
Persuade him the idea for him to stick around you and you to stick around for him.
Right.
I need to go on. The persuading, the reason is proving, it says, and he went in to tarry with them. It worked.
It's good.
I don't know about you, but when we all get back together here in this church, Amen. How about us taking this part of this message and let's make sure we get the Lord back in on this situation.
Amen.
When we get him in here, don't let him leave.
That's right.
Abide
good.
With us. Give him reasons. That's where it's going to be going there. How about the performing for this wonder? First of all, the place. It says, and as he sat at meat with them, all of a sudden they set a meal up, if you will. And as they set this meal up, there's where something's fixing to happen. Just as basic, if you will, numbers as a meal like this. The position, if you will, for this performing, it says, and it came to pass, as he said, it said, he took bread.
And blessed it.
Blessed it. Break it.
And gave
to them.
Yeah.
Whoa, 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 whoa. He's not the host of that house.
That's right.
Cleopas is. But you know what? That husband and that wife had sense enough to let the Lord take over.
Right.
It's good.
See, I don't know about you, but when he comes into your house and into your life, you need to let him have all the room.
Right. It's good.
Don't just keep him in the lobby area, in the what, that first place whenever you walk in.
The waiting,
when he first comes in. Now, matter of fact, let me show you. Sure. You realize, in other words, the host is supposed to take the bread, supposed to bless it, supposed to break it, supposed to divvy it out.
Right.
But there's where it is. The Bible says the Lord did this.
Right.
How about I thought about this in Revelation 3:20 came to mind. Behold, I stand at the door and knock. Mm-hmm. And if any man hear my voice and open the door, I will come in to him. Now it comes back into him personally. And will sup with him and he
with me.
With me.
It's good.
Amen. I don't know about you, but whenever, in other words, he comes into your house, let him have all of it.
Amen.
I'm afraid, in other words, the Lord, in other words, has been invited to people's houses and people's hearts. They can't go into every room.
Right.
They can't go into the TV room because of some of the ungodliest nonsense it is that they sit there and watch. Of numbers, all kinds of cheap sexual innuendos, the cussing, the drunkenness, the drug addiction and what have you on that line, whether it's a comedy or not, and sit there, numbers, and act like it's cute. Turn around and watching numbers, some of the most ungodliest nonsense could ever be imagined. I don't know about you, but you do realize people that make TV programs and movies like that, they're corruptors.
Yeah.
Right.
I get to thinking about that 3 and a Half Men years ago, it came on. You realize that one little young boy was perverted and corrupted by Charlie Sheen, and in other words, whoever that other yo-yo was.
Right.
Right.
Being raised in the middle of that whole thing. And what's his name? Wahlberg? Mark Wahlberg, you do realize there's where it is that him sitting there in front of the Pope, if you will, and all of a sudden this kid, in other words, talks about the idea how much it is he loved that one movie Mark Wahlberg made, in other words, Ted, with that stuffed bear that is the most ungodliest nonsense and what have you. And Wahlberg sits there and makes the statement to the idea, how in the world you even know about that movie? You ain't old enough to be able to even go and see that movie. Well, we can't go into the TV room.
Right.
Maybe we can go in the music room. No, I can't go in the music room because all of a sudden there's where it is. Country comes on. Mm-hmm. A little bit of rock, a little bit of rap, or a little bit of country rock, or a little, if you will, the words of Christian rock. Did I say rock? Mm-hmm. Rock. Rock. Same thing. So can't go in the music room. By the way, I don't know about you, but I don't appreciate these Christians sitting there talking about, in other words, their favorite little country and western stars and their songs and what have you. All that just shows me, my friend, you sit there and listen to ungodly nonsense you shouldn't listen to.
That's right.
Yeah.
And I don't know about you, but I Christians, my friend, posting stuff along the line that's the most ungodly nonsense could ever be imagined that's talked about is music.
Right.
It's crazy. I don't care if it's country, rock, pop. Anything else, I couldn't care less.
Amen.
Right.
Yeah.
It's nonsense. You're gonna let him take over your house.
Yeah.
Or in other words, well, you can't come to the refrigerator either because I got a little bit of drink in there like that. Mm-hmm. So, Lord, I guess you're just gonna have to stay here by the front door.
Yeah.
Guess what?
No,
he ain't sticking. He ain't stuck. He ain't staying.
That's right. Yeah.
He said, "What he's gonna do? Go right where he was at." In other words, apparently, in other words, at first,
right.
He's going to get right on the outside, and he's going to keep on knocking.
Amen.
Because you realize the context is him knocking at a backslidden church, if you will, trying to get back into his own church.
Yeah, that's right.
That's what Revelation 3:20 is, trying to get back into his own church.
Yeah, that's right.
Yeah. Okay, well, you need to hurry. The perception, if you will, in this wonder, all of a sudden God starts working wonders, and I need to hurry. The revelation says, and while Lourdes, he sat there and he break, blessed, and begin to, in the verse, give out that bread as far as their eyes were
opened.
Oh, is anybody seeing this thing right now? The revelation, if you will, all of a sudden, they realize this is the Lord Jesus Christ. Then all of a sudden, the recognition, it says, and they knew him who he really was, start to finish.
Yeah, that's good. Amen.
He's a risen Savior. He's in the world today. I know he said that he lives because he lives within my heart. Because I walk with him.
Talk with him
along life's narrow way.
Amen.
He lives. He lives. Salvation to impart. You ask me how I know he lives. I know because he lives in my heart. Let me go on. The recognition. The removal, all of a sudden, boom, he's vanished out of their sight.
Right.
Oh, you say, oh my goodness, he's gone again. Not, yeah, but now it's a different situation. They realize, no, he's not gone.
Right.
No, they still realize, in other words, the idea that all, if they want his presence, all they got to do is start talking about the things of God, and guess what? He shows up. Yeah. All they got to do is two or three to get together, and there he is in the midst of them. As a matter of fact, the Bible says the idea of teaching them to observe all things. If you go soul winning, guess what? Whatsoever I've commanded you, and lo, I am with you. Isn't that interesting? That's the resurrection Savior. He says, and I'll be with you unto the end of the world.
Amen.
All of God's people said,
amen.
Amen. Now I need to hurry. I got about 4 minutes, if you will, and that'll be an hour and a half. The profession, if you will, they talked about that holy heartburn. He said, in other words, man, that carried, he said, did not our heart burn within us while he talked, in other words, by the open? Didn't our heart, the cause of it, he said, because he talked with us, by the way, while he opened unto us the
scripture.
How many of you knows, my friend, that's what's going to keep you on fire for God? The
Amen.
Scripture. Nothing else. It's the scriptures. Mm-hmm. As a matter of fact, if you're not careful, my friend, just like Jeremiah, and I just got through preaching on this about the idea about the parable of the talents. Mm-hmm. That one talent individual decided he's not going to use that talent. I mean, you know, that's dangerous.
Amen.
Jeremiah could end up dying and going to hell, just like that one talent servant did there in Matthew chapter 25. Jeremiah says, he said, then I'll not make, he said, in other words, you've deceived me, Lord. Now, right. He knows that's what a backslider would say.
That's right.
He said, come on. You've deceived me, and I was deceived. I was a reproach to everybody. That's the verses before that. He said, I said, you know what? I'm not going to make mention of you, your name, of him, nor speak any more in his name. How many of you know? He said, you know what? I quit.
Right.
I've had it. I'm done. And this is it. He sat down there, in other words, and he's mad. He's sad.
He's bad.
And he's bad when you start talking about the Lord like that.
Amen.
There's where it is immediately. He says, but you know what? As I'm sitting there, the word is in my heart. As a burning fire shut up in my bones, I was weary with forbearing. I said, man, I just can't put this off anymore. And I could not stay.
Amen.
I couldn't do it. I had to get up. Smartest thing it is you can do during this time right now, whenever it is, in other words, you're hunkered down, if you will. You need to get yourself your Bible, open that thing up, in other words, and fill your heart up with the things with the Word of God.
Amen.
Come on, get yourself ready, my friend. You need to sit there and get your gun loaded. As soon as this thing's over with, we need to get after it, my friend. Get out there and get after it. I got to hurry.
Amen.
How about the idea, then, in other words, the consequences? It says, the consequences is whenever you all got that holy heartburn, you know how you spell relief? It's not R-O-L-A-I-D-S. It's not. It's the I, S-O-U-L-W-I-N-N-I-N-G. It's getting up and meeting the soul with him. The idea says, and they rose up the same hour and returned to Jerusalem. Right. Do you realize what that means? Can I preach to you just for a minute? That means the idea they walked two and a half hours, if you will, going 6.5 to 7 miles away. They sit down to a meal long enough to find out about the Lord and whatever on that line. And that same hour, guess what they did? They got right back up. And turn right back around, and in other words, and begin to start to head back to Jerusalem again.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
How many here knows that's somebody, my friend, that's hooked on soul winning.
That's right.
And I don't know about y'all, but I think we got some folks here right in this church, my friend, that they hooked that way.
Right.
And the reason is because I flooded, if you will, my sermons with the Word of God. How about the witness of his resurrection? First of all, the promise was that same hour they got up, they got after it.
Yeah.
All of a sudden, whenever they got there, the place, they turned right back to Jerusalem. Whenever they did that, they found the verse of the 11 gathered together, and there that they were with them. The particulars, if you will, the words of this witness was they talked about the resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ. The Lord is risen, what they say, indeed. No doubt about it. The women said they couldn't find him, but we found him. Yeah. The men says they sat there and looked inside, in other words, that grave, and it was empty, couldn't find the Lord. That's okay, we did.
Yeah,
come on. I don't know about you, but you realize that sometimes the hardest people, in other words, to witness to is those it is, my friend, that in other words, that are other believers.
Right, yeah.
Well, certainly those it is, my friend, that think the Lord is dead, that they're not part of their life as far as that goes. And there's where it is, in other words, they talk about the revelation. They had a testimony. They told them what things were done while they were in the way. They got a testimony, if you will, to give the verse of these individuals. And how that he was known of them in the breaking, it says, of the bread. How many of you knows the idea that there's where it is immediately? They had a captive audience. Now, if you read the rest of the scriptures and what have you about this whole thing, I just want to hit it right quick. Did you know that these individuals really didn't receive, in other words, what these two had to say? Not really. They gave them all this evidence and what have you on that line. And you know what the Lord had to do? He had to show up his own self, in other words, to the 11.
Right.
Mm. Say, what is your point? Hey, best thing to do is just keep witnessing. Keep witnessing. What will happen is you're witnessing, the Lord will show up. And when he does, there's where it is that will make the difference. No doubts about that. Let's bow our heads. With our heads bowed, our eyes closed, and no one looking about, Christians praying. I'm not really sure how to give, in other words, an invitation, in other words, like this, but I think seriously what I could do is simply if the Lord has spoken to your heart, you do realize I'm, of course, you know, I'm available 24 hours a day, so from Paul. If you need somebody to pray for you, text us, call us. I'm not really sure how to give an invitation in the midst of this situation. You can sit there, in other words, and you can use, in other words, if you're watching this thing and you're at your home right now, you realize, in other words, there's where it is, whatever you're sitting on, what have you, just get up, turn around and make, in other words, that seat that is that you're sitting in as an altar if you want to.
Sure.
I've done that. I've done funerals, and there's where it is, in other words, the people, in other words, have raised their hand to the idea about that God is speaking to their heart and dealing with them, and you can do exactly the same thing, in other words, right now. You can sit there, in other words, and realize, in other words, that God is working and doing. I don't know about you, but the Lord, in other words, don't want you sad. He don't want you mad. He don't want you bad. You know what he wants you? He wants you glad.
Yeah.
To the point, if you will, my friend, that even that word begins to start to burn in your heart. Wonders begin to start to happen. Your eyes begin to start to open up. All of a sudden, there's where it is you're able to realize the idea of what God's trying to do, and he reveals himself to you. And from that, there's where it is you're ready, or you're one of those Christians of, if you will, one of those Christians that are still, if you will, in the sense of the eye, you're just walking with the Lord, not really, in other words, realizing what's going on. Or are you just listening to the, are you just talking to the Lord, just wording back and forth? He's got a word for you, and if you'll let it, it'll work wonders in your life. And then from that, I guarantee you, when he's working wonders in your life, you'll be a witness for him. There's no doubts about that. In Jesus' name, amen.